Welcome back. Earlier we found that he had to run away from the London store, and in order to escape he had to put off his clothes again, and thus he became invisible but naked in the cold January air. This time he decided to try the stock of a theatrical company in the hope of finding not only clothes but also something that would hide the empty space above his shoulders. Shivering with cold, he hurried to Drury Lane, the center of the theater world. Now, what happened there, you see? Every time he wears some kind of dress, whatever kind of dress you wear, it does not cover the neck part and the face. So, this time he decided to wear something that covers the neck part as well as the face. And this is available nowhere else but in a theatrical shop. So, he decided to try the stock of a theatrical company. Why? In the hope of finding not only clothes but also something that would hide the empty space above the shoulder. Clear? Shivering with cold, he hurried to Drury Lane. So shivering, you understand? In winter we tremble out thandalage sort of thing. You understand it? So shivering with cold, he did what? He hurried to Drury Lane. What is Drury Lane? It is the center of the theater world. He soon found a suitable show. He made his way invisible upstairs because he was there was no clothes, so he entered and nobody saw him. So he made his way upstairs. You understand upstairs, downstairs? So upstairs. Invisible upstairs, came out a little later wearing bandages around his forehead, dark glasses, false nose, big bushy side whiskers, and a large hat. To escape without being seen, he callously attacked the shopkeeper from behind, after which he robbed him of all the money he could find. Now, he did what? He reached the place untraced. There, he went up, wore every kind of dress, you understand it? He wore all theatrical things and the bandages to cover his forehead and other vacant spaces. Clear? What did he wear? Just mark the words. What did he wear? He wore bandages around his forehead, dark glasses, false nose, big bushy side whiskers. You understand side whisker? Side whiskers and a large hat. To escape without being seen, he callously attacked the shopkeeper. He callously, you understand? Casual, callous one, like without any precaution or any cautious fact, you understand it? Like without taking care of what will be the consequence of it, he callously attacked the shopkeeper from behind. After which he robbed him. Robbing, you understand, looting. He robbed him of all the money he could find. Rob, the preposition followed after rob is of. Okay. So he robbed him of all the money. Of all the money, preposition. Of is the preposition. Of all the money he could find. Eager to get away from crowded London, he took a train to the village of Iping, where he booked two rooms at the local inn. The arrival of a stranger at an inn in winter was in any case an unusual event. A stranger of such uncommon appearance set all tongues wagging. Mrs. Hall, the landlord's wife, made every effort to be friendly, but Griffin had no desire to talk and told her, "My reason for coming to Iping is a desire for solitude. I do not wish to be disturbed in my work. Besides, an accident has affected my face." Understood? Now, the arrival of a stranger at an inn in winter was in any case an unusual event, because winter days are not the days to be frequented by. You understand it? Not the day. Let me tell you. Wait a minute. So, he did what? Eager to get away from crowded London, he took a train to the village of Iping. Now he was willing, eager means willing, willing to get away from crowded London. London is crowded, it's full of things and all. So quite naturally he will be sought after and people, he will get traced easily. So in order to get away from crowded London, he took a train to the village of Iping. Where? To the village of Iping, where he booked two rooms at the local inn. Inn is actually, you may say, it's like a hotel cum residential hotel, you call it. Inn, I-N-N, inn. Okay, where people come and take food and go, although there is a provision for food and lodging also. Clear? So, similar sort of thing. Now, what I mean, the arrival of a stranger at an inn in winter was in any case an unusual event. Because in winter, people don't visit. Now, such visit of a stranger, unknown fellow, at this time of the year, it was an unusual event. Hey, what's wrong? What are you doing? Whom? Who did you want to call? Who do you want to call?
Sir, I have to call my mother.
Why?
She don't know that today there is no class. If she
sees, she will make a call to me. If she sees it, she will make a call. Go and sit first. It's already on record. The class is on record. This is also recorded. That Boronjit came and Boronjit is talking like this. It is also being recorded. So without making much ado, just sit and attend the class. Maintain distance. Well, Let's see. So, what happened there, you see? The arrival of a stranger at an inn in winter was in any case an unusual event. It was never an usual event. Okay, a usual event. So, it was an unusual event. A stranger of such uncommon appearance had all tongues wagging. You understand? A man came with the whole face covered, bandaged. Clear? With such an uncommon appearance, a person arrived. Now, this man, who the man may be, what's the matter? Yeah, the appearance looks very bad. You know it, it's like a gossip. So, everybody started talking about it in the inn. Mrs. Hall, the landlord's wife, made every effort to be friendly. And Mrs. Hall, who is Mrs. Hall? Mr. Hall's wife, Mrs. Hall, landlord's wife, made every effort to be friendly. Understood? Landlord's wife, she made every effort to be friendly. But Griffin had no desire to talk. But the thing is what? Griffin had no desire to talk and told her, my reason for coming to Iping is a desire for solitude. What is the reason? My reason for coming to Iping is what? Was a desire for solitude. I want to stay lonely. I want to stay lonely. That's why I am here. I do not wish to be disturbed in my work. I do not wish to be disturbed in my work. Besides, now he is covering up other things. Because he had his face bandaged. So he's referring to that also. He said, besides, an accident has affected my face. Besides, apart from that, number one, I want to be lonely. And number two, an accident has affected my face. Satisfied that her guest was an eccentric scientist, and in view of the fact that he had paid her in advance, Mrs. Hall was prepared to excuse his strange habits and irritable temper. But the stolen money did not last long, and presently Griffin had to admit that he had no more ready cash. He pretended, however, that he was expecting a check to arrive at any moment. Now what happened? The lady, though she did not get good response from Griffin, but she was happy. She was satisfied. Why was she satisfied? That her guest was an eccentric scientist, a crazy scientist. Clear? And in view of the fact that he had paid her in advance, the payment was also made in advance. So what's the use of talking to you and becoming friendly? No need. Carry on with your own behavior. You paid the money, that's okay. Thank you very much. And that also in this odd season. So she was satisfied with all these things. So she excused his strange habits and irritable temper. Irritable, you understand? Irritating temper. But the stolen money did not last long. Where was it stolen from? Where was the money stolen from? From the theatrical show. Theatrical show. Okay. So the stolen money did not last long, and he had to admit that he didn't have much ready cash. Clear to you? He pretended, however, that he was expecting a check to arrive at any moment. Clear? Is that clear? He pretended, however, that he was expecting a check to arrive at any moment. Shortly afterwards, a curious episode occurred. Very early in the morning, a clergyman and his wife were awakened by noises in the study. Creeping downstairs, they heard the chink of money being taken from the clergyman's desk. Without making any noise and with a poker, you understand poke, something used to poke somebody. You understand poking? Poking, like you take something pointed, sometimes it is there in the habit of students, opening the pen and using it to poke at somebody else. And then, no, I haven't done it, you have done it, so probably someone else, no, I haven't done it. Poking, you understand it? Now, when it's a big one with a long stick, heavy and forefront of the front part pointed, poker. Clear? Now, what happened there, you see? The incident is very, you can say, important. You may be asked a question regarding it. Now, what happened? He didn't have money. Now, he had to manage the money. He said he will be getting a check shortly. But what actually happened there? A curious episode took place. What happened? Very early in the morning, a clergyman, you understand clergy? A clergyman, the French Revolution, in that chapter you came across this term also. Related to? A clergy is related to? Church, very good. So, very early in the morning, a clergyman, a purohit, we call it priest sort of thing. Clergyman and his wife were awakened. Awakened, you understand? Awakened by what? Awakened by noises in the study. Study means study room. Creeping downstairs. Creeping means coming slowly. Creeping, you understand, like a baby creeps. So, creeping downstairs, they heard the chink of money, the sound of money being taken from the clergyman's desk. Without making any noise and with a poker grasped firmly in his hand. Poker grasped means held firmly, strongly in his hand. The clergyman flung open the door. You understand it? Like opening it all of a sudden. Hey, who is there? Like kind of thing. Just imagine, Borunjit is there now waiting. He is the clergyman. He crept and with a poker in his hand, all of a sudden he opened the door. Like that. Clear. And then surrender. Clear? Now what happened? Then to his amazement, he realized that the room appeared to be empty. He and his wife looked under the desk and behind the curtains, even up the chimney. There wasn't a sign of anybody. Yet the desk had been opened and the housekeeping money was missing. Extraordinary affair, the clergyman kept saying for the rest of the day. So there was noise, the desk was opened, everything showed that somebody came. The sound was heard, the moment they entered, there was nobody. They searched everywhere, behind the curtains to up the chimney, but nobody was there. The clergyman was baffled and the whole day he was found mumbling, saying, extraordinary affair. But it was not as extraordinary as the behavior of Mrs. Hall's furniture a little later that morning. But on that morning, something else happened and that was even more extraordinary. That was with Mrs. Hall's furniture. So probably the furniture moved downstairs or showed something. Let's see what happened. The landlord and his wife were up very early and were surprised to see the scientist's door wide open. Usually, it was shut and locked, and he was furious if anyone entered his room. The opportunity seemed too good to be missed. They peeped around the door, saw nobody, and decided to investigate. The bedclothes were cold, showing that the scientist must have been up for some time. And stranger still, the clothes and bandages that he always wore were lying about the room. Now, what happened there, you see? The landlord and his wife were up very early. They woke up very early and were surprised. They got surprised. Surprised? Why were they surprised? They were surprised to see that the scientist's door was wide open. Scientist's door was wide open. Now, usually it was shut and locked. Normally it was shut and locked. And he was furious. He was very angry if anyone entered his room. So this time, it was a golden opportunity. The opportunity seemed too good to be missed. So good that it could be missed. So they wanted to investigate. They were curious. So they peeped. Peeping, you understand? Huh? You understand peeping? Like, huh? Yes, very good. You call, in Bengali it said, Uki mere dekha. It's good. So they peeped around the door, saw nobody, and decided to investigate. The bedclothes were cold. So it means what? The person sleeping there was, in fact, he woke up very early. That's why the bedclothes were old, very cold. Showing that the scientist must have been up for some time. And he was still a stranger because his face was bandaged. So they didn't know how the scientist looked. Clear? So what happened there? Showing that the scientist must have been up for some time. And stranger still, the cloths and bandages that he always wore were lying about the room. They were lying about the room, you understand? They're fallen scattered. Clear? All of a sudden, Mrs. Hall heard a sniff close to her ear. All of a sudden, Mrs. Hall heard a... In winter, if we go naked, means if we wear even, you can say, simple clothes and all, light clothes, we catch cold. And he went naked to rob the clergyman. And so he caught cold. And so the landlady, Mrs. Hall, heard a sniff near her ears. Clear? Now what happened there, you see? A moment later, the hat on the bedpost lifted up and dashed into her face. Now, on the bedpost, you understand? Near the bed, there we keep things and all. Clear? Like you can say hangar kind of thing and all, kept there, like stick and all, where things are kept. Okay, bedpost. Normally, mosquito nets are also hung on bedpost. So, she saw the hat. Hat, you understand the difference between hat and a cap? The hat is a little bigger and elevated also, with height. So she observed that the hat came up because nobody could be seen. So the hat came up and dashed on her face. Straight on her face it went. Now what happened here? Then the bedroom chair became alive. And now the chair became alive. Because nobody could be seen. So you could see the movement of the chair, but not any individual. So the chair became alive. Springing into the air, it charged straight at her, legs foremost. Now, legs in the front side, the chair came straight at her. At her means at whom? At the landlady. Landlady, Mrs. Hall. As she and her husband turned away in terror, the extraordinary chair pushed them both out of the room. This time they were afraid and they wanted to go out. The chair pushed them out of the room. And then appeared to slam and lock the door after them. And then, on their face, the door slammed and it was locked. Clear to you? Mrs. Hall almost fell down the stairs in hysterics. She was so much afraid, understood and disturbed, that she almost fell down in hysterics, fainting. Clear? She almost fainted and fell down. She was convinced that the room was haunted by spirits. She was now convinced that there was gothic things, ghost-based things and all. Clear? And that the stranger had somehow caused this to enter her furniture. And somehow this scientist was responsible behind it. Because she didn't even know that it was the scientist who was doing it. She thought what? It was the magic of the scientist. Clear? Costly activity related to the scientist. And the scientist had somehow made the spirit enter the chair and the chair became alive. Clear? She thought that way. My poor mother used to sit in that chair. She moaned. She used to cry that way. To think it should rise up against me now. And this chair rose up against me now to attack me. My goodness. Now, the feeling among the neighbors was that the trouble was caused by witchcraft. The neighbors thought that it was black magic. Clear? But witchcraft or not, when news of the burglary at the clergyman's home became known, the strange scientist was strongly suspected of having had a hand in it. Suspicion grew even stronger when he suddenly produced some ready cash, though he had admitted no long before that he had no money. Now, something happened. The feeling among the neighbors was that the trouble was caused by witchcraft. And whether it was witchcraft or not, but one factor is very true, and it is what? That the scientist had something to do with it. Clear? And moreover, when the news of the burglary, of the loot in the clergyman's house became known to all, scientist was suspected of it. Clear? And suspicion grew even stronger when he all of a sudden wanted to pay the money to the landlord. Clear? Because very recently he said that he didn't have much money. He didn't have money, so he'll have to wait. He'll have to wait and pay the money then. Clear? You understand the point? So it happened that way. The village constable was secretly sent for, and so they did what? They sent for the village constable. Village constable was secretly sent for. Instead of waiting for the constable, Mrs. Hall went to the scientist who had somehow mysteriously appeared from his empty room. So although the village constable was called for, she, the landlady, Mrs. Hall, did not wait. She went straightway to the scientist's room to charge him, hey, you, and all these things. Clear? Who appeared from nowhere. Clear? Because by that time he owed his dress, and now he was visible. So he came out, who somehow mysteriously appeared from his empty bedroom. I want to know what you have been doing to my chair upstairs. I want to know from you what you had been doing to my chair upstairs, she demanded. And I want to know how it is you came out of an empty room and how you entered a locked room. I also want to know how you came out of an empty room and how you entered the locked room. I want to know these things. Clear? So the photograph will tell you what's going to happen next. Let's see. The scientist was quick-tempered. Quick-tempered, you understand? Short-tempered, we may call it. Okay, quick-tempered. Now he became furious. You don't understand who or what I am, he shouted. Very well, I'll show you. Suddenly, he threw off bandages, as you see here in the picture. Suddenly, he did what? He threw off bandages, whiskers, spectacles, and even nose. False nose. Nose means not the real nose. False nose that he got from the theatrical show. It took him only a minute to do this. The horrified people in the bar found themselves staring at a headless man. And so, the people in the bar, they were very much horrified. You understand? They were very much afraid, horrified. That's why they were looking at a headless man. Clear? So, wherever there is no cloth, it's not there. Non-existent as far as vision is concerned. So, they saw as if they are looking at a headless man. Clear? Mr. Jeffers, the constable, now arrived. And by that time, the constable arrived and was quite surprised to find that he had to arrest a man without a head. And he was quite surprised. Why was he surprised? Surprised to find that he had to arrest a man without a head. But Jeffers was not easily prevented from doing his duty. But the thing is what? Jeffers was not easily prevented from doing his duty. He was assigned to arrest the scientist. So he has to do it. Doesn't matter whether the man has a head or not. So it's like this, you see. If a magistrate's warrant ordered a person's arrest, then that person had to be arrested with or without a head. I have to arrest him. That's the order, so I have to do it. That was the kind of person the constable was. There followed a remarkable scene as the policeman tried to get hold of a man who was becoming more and more invisible as he threw off one garment after another. And this time, the scientist was putting off all garments and he was becoming invisible. Because with time, he was just putting off clothes and every part that is becoming naked, becoming invisible. Clear? Now, what happened? Finally, a shard flew into the air. And the constable found himself struggling with someone he could not see at all. So he found himself fighting with somebody who he could not see at all. So can you fight with an invisible man? You cannot expect where from you get the next blow. So that's the thing. Some people tried to help him but found themselves hit by blows that seemed to come from nowhere. Some others tried to help him and they received blows from nowhere because they could not know. They didn't know even where from they were getting the blows. They could not see anything. Clear? In the end, Jeffers was knocked unconscious as he made a last attempt to hold on to the unseen scientist. And ultimately, Jeffers was knocked unconscious, means he got a knock and he fell unconscious. Clear? Up to this is okay? There were nervous, excited cries of hold him. And so there was this nervous and excited cries, hold him, hold him, hold him. But this was easier said than done. But this was easier to say than holding him. Griffin had shaken himself free and no one knew where to lay hands on him. And so he made himself free, and so nobody knew where to lay hands on him because he was invisible and they didn't know where he was at next moment. Up to this is okay? I hope it is understood. If you have any queries, do ask me. Feel free to ask me.